Hi, and welcome to the outside of the most famous comprehensive school in the world, Grange Hill. But if you think this looks like an office block and not a school, then you're not wrong, because that's what it is. It's the outside of the BBC production centre at Elstree. And we use this as the entrance to Grange Hill when we're filming the outside stuff. And the playground, it's just a car park. It's round the corner. And these ain't real school gates. They're just part of the scenery. Here, I hope I ain't spoiling it for you. We do use a real school sometimes. For assemblies, gym scenes, stuff like that. But most of our corridors and classrooms are make-believe. Like the school gates. It's all done over there in the Grange Hill studio. I'll show you that later. But the first thing I'm going to do is take you back to April, when the actors started working on the new series, Series 11. It all started up there, in the Grange Hill rehearsal rooms.
John.
This is the first thing we do. We get round in a circle and read the new scripts through. See how it sounds. Me and my old sixth form mates won't be in the new series, but there'll still be plenty of faces you recognise.
There is.
Ziggy and Robbie, for starters.
My dad's job, he came home last night, reckons he might be getting the old elbow, you know? Well, if you're on the dole, at least life's a bit cheaper up there.
How that bad, is it?
Yeah. But don't tell anyone yet, will you?
Alright.
But there's some new young actors you won't have seen before. They may be feeling a bit nervous now, but my guess is they're really chuffed. They've landed a main part in Grange Hill.
Did you ever think you'd be on Grange Hill?
Never. Never. Never even dreamed of it.
I was queuing up for dinner and my mum came into the school and I said, well, what's wrong, Mum? And she said, oh, Sean, you got the part. And at first I didn't believe her. But then she told me again and I couldn't believe it. I was really, really happy.
There was only six parts going. Hundreds and hundreds of kids were auditioned from all over London. But the final auditions were held here at Elstree. You had to learn three pieces and act them out in front of the Grange Hill bosses.
Where'd you get them earrings?
There was a present.
I'd learnt the script.
Where from? They look really expensive.
And I had to act it out.
What?
I was so nervous.
It's probably my year.
You got a boyfriend?
That's Phil Redmond on the right, who thinks up Grange Hill.
Right?
And on the left is Anthony Minghella, the script editor. And Lee Jackson, the other script editor.
One brother, Mark.
Ronald Smedley, the producer, who's reading all the other parts.
Don't you ever want to
and Albert
Mark?
Barber,
no way,
one of the directors.
One of the filth, a copper. Thank you very much, Rachel. OK?
Yeah.
Thanks very much, love. Do you want the paper or shall I throw it in the bin?
Throw it in the bin if you want.
I'll throw it in the
bin. I don't really need it.
No, OK. So you married?
No, in youth custody.
What for?
Burglary.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Tragic. I was a bit shy because I wasn't very sure of who all the people were. And at that time I didn't know who Phil Redmond was. All that time my mind was blank. All I was thinking of was the script and whether I was going to get it right or not.
I doubt it.
Just left me to carry on the family business single-handed.
Don't you ever want to see your mother?
No way. The bloke she went off with was one of the filth, you know, a copper.
Just while we're getting ourselves sorted out.
Now the read-through is finished.
And then can I have a word with John Alford, Steve West, John Drummond and Jonathan Lambeth? I know it'll be exciting for a bit, then it'll soon get boring, but make sure you don't run around. Get under people's feet. You see, you come to a place which isn't like a school. It's a busy place where people are working. So you have to behave like adults, which is a bit hard when you're only 10. Okay? So you've got to stay with somebody the whole time, either with June or with Maureen, whoever's with you.
You have to go with the chaperones everywhere you go. Like, you mustn't go anywhere without the chaperones in case you get hurt or something goes wrong.
My mum's one of the chaperones. The chaperones have to look after all the actors who are under 16. All the time. It's the law. It's a difficult situation for the kids once they get older.
You're nearly 16 now, aren't you?
Yeah.
But you still have to be chaperoned.
I know.
I know it's tedious because you're nearly 16, but I'm going to ask you to be very cooperative and set a terrific example to the little ones.
All right.
Because we'll have a lot of under 12s this year, so there's going to be a lot on your shoulders.
Yeah.
Okay, then. Okay. And you're all going to do this football? You're not doing the football. You're doing
nothing
football.
About it.
We rehearsed 2 episodes a week in this room. Afternoons only, because the kids go to school in the mornings. The sets we're going to use are marked out on the floor by coloured tape. And poles like these, they used to stand in for doors and things like that.
Now, let me just explain. You're on the stairs now, right? You're coming down from the highest level. You go round this corner here and onto these stairs that are marked on the ground. Okay, when you get to the bottom of those, you go round another corner. As you go round this corner...
I'll smash the fire alarm.
You smash the fire alarm, which is on this wall here. They've had their script for a couple of weeks before they come in here, and some of them have begun to learn their script. So they know the words, but they don't know where they're going to move or where they're sitting as they're saying those words. Thank you.
Steady on, Vince. Look where you're going.
So do you know anything about America?
Which part?
Which parts are there?
States, Vince. States.
Vince and Trev go down the stairs. Vince knocks against a pole that's going to mark where a fire alarm will be in the studio.
Vince!
And this is what the scene will look like in the final programme.
Vince, look where you're going.
Sir, do you know anything about America?
Which part?
Which parts are there?
Not parts, states, you idiot.
You'll be in a state, you don't concentrate, Trevor.
Yeah.
Look out! Vince!
Their attitude in rehearsals is very professional. I mean, most of them know their lines, and they bring an enormous amount of energy, which is can sometimes be lacking in adult actors.
Come on!
Mr. Orthodox, this is disgusting behaviour. Really is!
Right. And Vince.
We ain't got Vince.
Oliver, we're missing Vince. Right, okay, while we're waiting for him, let's just do positions. Ziggy and Trev here. Okay, Ziggy there, Trev there, good. Robbie here, and Vince here. Okay.
Hello, Steve. Hello, Steve.
Steve, you're next to John.
Hello, mate.
Okay,
come on. This is savage.
And again, John, please, from the top.
You know what did smash the alarm, don't you? Old Dodo Davy, Mr. US of A Savage.
In an emergency, break glass.
Yeah, did you feel a ringing in your ears, did you, Mr. Savage? The bells! The bells!
What are you moaning about, Cleaver? At least we're missing double French.
Well, Mrs. Donington.
Right, okay.
Am I doing it in a Quasimodo? Yeah, why am I not? Yeah.
Yes, I better
read the script this time.
Do you know what a Quasimodo impression is?
Yeah.
The bells!
No, look at the camera away from me. This is Libby, this is.
What's your mum do?
She works in a DIY shop. I've got a really boring family. What's your mum do?
The bloke.
She met some geezer.
She met some geezer the last time my dad was banged up.
In hospital, do you mean?
No, prison.
I think the new children, the younger children, are doing very well indeed. They're still working out their characters. Their characters are new to them. Some of the older children have been playing those parts for 3 years, 4 years, whatever, and they know their characters inside out. The younger children are still finding their characters.
Then at the end of the week, on Friday afternoon, you run through both episodes for the producer. It's called a producer's run.
It's where you go through the 2 episodes you've been doing that week. It's always on a Friday. It's where the producer and director and script editors and everyone who's in it have to be there. And we just go through everything once, the whole 2 episodes, just like we were acting out on telly.
You worry about what I did about your hair?
Yeah.
Just don't shave it. Just leave it like that. That's fine.
Oh,
just
right.
So that the difference between the shaved bit and your own hair at the top isn't too
well. Oh, I thought you meant...
Just leave it. That's lovely.
Yeah, I thought you meant cut it all off, because I was going to cut it all off.
All right, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, quiet, please. First of all, can I just remind people, some people seem to be forgetting, Sony Walkmans are not to be used in the rehearsal room. Right, we'd like a very quick run, please, for the producer. Very quiet, and please be ready for your scenes when we come up to them.
It's like a show, the first night of a show, because it's the one thing you've got to get it right first time, and that's it, because the producer's there.
And everyone's quiet, it's their quiet, and you've got to do it. It's like actually being filmed, because you've got to get it right, really. I mean, because you're watching and you're doing it. And this is like a dress rehearsal of what you're going to do on the day when you're filming. It's exactly what you're going to be doing. So it is a little bit more tense.
Very quiet, please.
Thank you.
You weren't in there, Maula. I saw him go in there.
I can't concentrate without silence, please. Absolute quiet.
You weren't in there, Maula.
Just a minute, start again.
OK, and stop moving around, please. Just keep still until you're needed. Thank you.
You weren't in there, Maula. I saw him go in there with my own eyes.
Must have slipped out again.
Are you sure?
The room was empty.
I feel the performances in producers' runs are always very forced. It's like, it's almost like performing for one's parents or aiming to do well rather than just relaxing and doing it. I know it's necessary, but I do find it a very strained atmosphere and rather tense. I'm sure the children enjoy it, but I can't cope with it at all.
I don't intend to keep you out here any longer. File back to your classes quietly, starting with the first years.
First years move and cue.
No set alarm, don't you? Old Dodo Daydream, Mr. US of A Savage over there.
In case of emergency. Break glass.
Did you feel a ringing in your ears, eh, Mr. Sav?
The bells! The bells!
I don't know what you're moaning about, Cleaver. At least the missing double French.
Ooh. Thank you.
Going on to 723 in the biology lab, Mrs. Reagan, G1 and N1.
When we've run the episodes through, we go off for a cup of tea, while the producer, the director and the script editor talk about what they've seen.
Again, this is a very difficult scene to play for Trev. The bells, unless the other two boys help him. See, at the moment, George and John are just standing there because they're so cross because they've only got one line in this episode. They're just standing there doing absolutely nothing like posts. So poor John's got nothing to work with.
That's right.
So all three boys have got to be giggly. Even if they've got nothing to say, they've got to be giggly. So that the bells comes into just the same sort of giggly mood. Otherwise, poor old Trev's going to look a total lemon.
Now it's time to stop rehearsing and start recording. This is when the supporting artists or extras join us. We've got 106 extras. Some of them go to stage schools, but most of them go to ordinary schools like I did. All of the extras are under 16, so just like the principals, they can only work a certain number of days a year. They're not allowed to go to Elstree on their own, and they have to stay with the chaperones all day. The first thing we do is get changed into our Grange uniforms before we go to breakfast in the BBC canteen. Of course, when you get to 16, you earn more money and you get a proper dressing room. After breakfast, the under-16s go to what's called the green room, and the chaperones sort everybody out for the day's work. That's my mum.
Your clothes are all over the place and someone else has to hang them up.
So?
Do you usually chuck them on the floor or do you usually hang them up? You usually chuck them on the floor?
Yeah, my wrist.
Well, you mustn't do that if 100 people are in. Supposing everybody did that. No, you mustn't laugh. You must hang your clothes up.
This is a busy time for the chaperones.
Have you had any special training to be chaperones?
No, only training as mums, you know. We just look after them as we would our own children.
So the training is experience, really?
Yes, exactly.
So the majority of them treat us as chaperones like their mums.
And with respect.
Yeah. Which is quite nice.
Because they're suppressed such a lot. I mean, they're even tutoring or in studio where they're really kept under. So if they're with us, probably more than their parents when they're working on here. So we really have all got to get into, you know, to a certain extent, really, haven't we?
Yeah.
People in G1, put your hands up. I want you to go through into reception. Now, this is to stop a bottleneck. Are you still listening at the back?
This is the first scene of the day, which is supposed to be outside the school. Vince has set off the fire alarm, so the whole school has been turned out. Or at least as much as 106 extras and 26 principals can make it look like a whole school.
Fan out along here. Can we have our principals, please? Quiet!
He had to do it.
Anyone put your hands up, please.
Now, the director is in the control room, and that's his voice you can hear, talking to Ken, the production manager.
Now, Ken,
yeah?
Would you break the front row up just a little bit, please? The girls on the left could come forward, two or three. Just bring them a little bit closer, so they're not all standing in a row.
What's it like to be an extra?
I really enjoy it because it's good fun and it's hard work as well. But it's good experience when you're older because you might as well start from the bottom and work up.
That's interesting because I'd never done any TV work before I came to Grange Hill. And it's a lot of experience to see what goes on behind the set.
How long have you been on Grange Hill?
About a month, 2 months. Not very
long.
Quite
a short time.
Yeah.
Is it like you expected it would be?
No. I thought it would be more exciting, but it's still good. It's a lot of fun.
What did you think would be more exciting?
The actual filming, like, you know, more jumping about and everything.
So what is it, if it's not?
It's basically talking to your friend, walking past the principals and doing quite a lot of things, cooking sometimes. If you're lucky.
I've been doing it for a long time, so.
How long?
3 years now.
3 years you've been an extra.
Yeah.
So some people might think you get very bored by it.
Yeah, now. Some people say, don't you get bored of it? And I say, no. Because I've liked doing Grange Hill, that's why I've carried on.
Today was a false alarm, which is just as well. Because if there'd been an actual fire, some of you wouldn't be here to tell the tale.
Do people sometimes think you're a real head teacher? I'm talking about people.
Yes, very often. Very often. In fact, I've even had real headmasters invite me to their schools to see how it compares with my own. I'm very often get asked what I think about teachers' pay and the recent bout of strikes. And
so what do you say?
Well, I do try to point out to people that actually I'm an actress and political side of Mrs. McCluskey is never referred to in Grange Hill, and therefore I know nothing about it whatsoever.
How many? How many?
You do have to be patient, but you can't help mucking about sometimes.
George!
Any more trouble, and we're going to have a lot of unpleasantness during this season.
All right, go.
I expect somebody of your calibre to actually be slightly better when we've got a lot of people out here.
All right?
All right, good. Come on. Any more trouble and you'll be off. Now come forward. Yeah, okay.
Do the boys give you more trouble than the girls?
No, I think there's totally different. The boys are more boisterous. And the girls are different in their own way. You know, we know the boys are there and they're driving you mad, but the girls probably doing it equally as bad, but quietly in the corner.
Quietly, but they are.
Till we find them doing it. But that's if they're doing anything bad.
The boys seem to sort of treat us like their mums, more so than the girls.
Mm. Why do you think that is?
I don't know, really. Perhaps it's because we're telling the boys off more so than the girls. they're trying they keep to sort
us
of,
get around us.
Sorry, Maureen.
So they keep cuddling us to get
to
around
get round
us.
Sweet,
yeah. I can honestly say, out of the older boys, I think they've got a lot of respect. And if you talk to them nicely, you do get it back.
You get respect back.
If you show respect to the children, you get the respect back. They respect you.
In television, you have to be very precise. If you're not standing in exactly the right spot, the camera can't see you.
Can we get into position, please? Okay, please, on your cue. You all go in as before.
George, I don't want George to move. Good Callie. John Drummond out.
Move out. Right.
Callie, move to her left.
Can you go to your left, please?
And Tina as well, that's it.
John, right.
Right, okay, that's fine. When the exit leaves, they must be completely quiet. Right. Okay, they can look at their chatting, but they must be quiet. They must remind each other. I don't want any sound at all from anybody as they're going up towards the school.
I want absolute silence from everybody, please. Shot 108, take one. Okay, here we go, and...
Action.
General action.
Top 108, 3 net.
Thank you, the boys.
You know who broke the alarm, didn't you? Miss, sorry.
Right. Cut! Hey. Start, please, quickly, before this rain starts getting any heavier. Okay, here we go. Quiet, please. 108, take two. And general action.
Thank you, the boys.
You know who set the alarm off, didn't you? Old Dodo Davey, Mr. US of A7.
In case of emergency. Smash glass.
You feel a ringing in your ears, Mr. Savage?
Yeah. Listen. The bill! The bill!
I don't know what you're moaning about, Cleaver. At least we're missing double French.
Ooh. Come on, Dozy. It's all right, mate.
We'll buy that. Everything worked very nicely. Stop recording and we'll move inside, Ken.
Thank you. Thank you. Right, that's finished here.
All back into the green room.
All back into the green room.
We're not in the studio yet. This is a real classroom, not a make-believe one. If you're under 16, you have to spend half a day in one of these classrooms doing what's called tutoring. Ian's a senior tutor. He makes sure everyone brings in the work they'd have to be doing at school.
They're then expected to come into the classroom and to sit down and just generally to work through with supervision. We have a minimum duration of 3 hours spread throughout the day, so they're not in for 3 hours solidly in the same room.
The tutors are really helpful, and there's only about 12 in a class, so if you get stuck, they're always there to help you.
You have 3 hours minimum just writing, doing maths, English, reading, whatever like that. Now, if you cut out the P's in real school time, I think you'd be doing just the exact same as you do in tutoring.
I quite enjoy it, because otherwise, you know, I get a bit bored if you don't have anything to do. I get bored, I tend to do tutoring.
Sit, wait, nerf, dace.
I used to absolutely hate it. That was the only thing I didn't like about filming, I think. The worst thing was being tutored. I just used to... It's just so boring.
I find it better than school.
Why?
Because you can settle down a lot easier and get on with your work.
Do you think your work is suffering?
Not really.
You have to get a decent education anyway if you want to get a job when you leave. I mean, it's no good if you're a dunce, you know? I mean, you can't just say, well, I wasn't telling you. It won't get you anywhere afterwards.
Can I see the work that you're doing, please, Sean?
This is a story about America, isn't it? Can I sit down? No.
How do you get on with Ian?
Well, he's like sort of the head of them, and he's the strictest, but they really need someone strict, because if they had no one strict, if someone was naughty, they'd have no one to send them to. It's like the headmaster, really.
Sometimes he's all right and we can have a joke and that, but, like,
once someone goes over the top or does something wrong, then I don't think you want to get the wrong side with Ian.
How do you get on with Ian, the tutor?
Fine. Funny enough, he's my favourite tutor. He's my favourite tutor. I like Ian because he's strict.
When you go in his classroom and you don't really feel like doing a lot of work, he makes you do a lot of work. And he don't really let you talk. You know, he just says, get on with your work. I mean, some of the time you can't even whisper.
Do you mind being unpopular?
Not at all. I think if I was a teacher who was upset by being disliked, then I wouldn't be able to do my job.
You wouldn't be able to do this job, or wouldn't be able to be a teacher?
Wouldn't be able to be a teacher. I think it's one thing that you must accept, that the children may dislike you for some of the time, but that changes.
But he helps you with your work a lot. But my favourite tutor is Joe.
Right, now you've got to say what you are.
Right. All right. My name is John Drummond, MP for Billericay East. I think I should stay in a balloon because, one, I can help to run the government.
John Alford is nearly 16, so he's in his fifth year now at his real school, which is called Eccleham Burley in North London.
I stopped after three teachers, John, because I knew the message was going to be the same. You're very, very much down on all your coursework, correct?
Yeah, I'm a lot behind.
You're a lot behind. Being totally honest, do you think you could catch up in time for next Christmas when we enter pupils for the exam? So you said no?
Yeah.
Okay. I can take that. I hope you can as well. What I don't want you doing is seeing me perhaps outside in a few years' time and saying, why didn't you make me do this, Brankin? You know, why didn't you push me harder? Because I'm having to do these exams now if I want to get anywhere.
Do you think I'm irresponsible in having had this influence on John's life?
I see school as a preparation for life outside school. And from that point of view, I know that the main concern of most of our fourth and fifth years is, will I get a job? John has a job at the moment. I think you're not being irresponsible if you can offer a pupil a chance to follow their chosen profession. I wish I could give every kid in the fourth year the same chance.
Do you think it's impossible to do Grange Hill and keep up academic work?
I think you have to be a very special type of youngster. And it's not an easy thing to ask of someone of John's age to have that maturity, to have that foresight. I would say it's not impossible, but I don't think that that is possible for John. And I don't think, just from my own views on the cast, that it would be possible for a large number of those kids in Grange Hill.
You've left school now, haven't you?
Yeah.
How did you cope with your schoolwork and Grange Hill at the same time?
Well, I thought I'd done very well. Any time I wasn't at Grange Hill, I was always at school doing my work, and I came out with, I think, 3 O-levels and a CSE. And I'm sure if I hadn't have been doing Grange Hill, I might have come out with less.
Because in the end, I got 6 O-levels, which was surprising.
I think what it was, you come to Grange Hill, you get into a routine of coming to Grange Hill, and you also enjoy Grange Hill a lot more than school. I always did. I enjoyed it a lot more. And so then you go back to school and it's a lot more boring and you've got to sit down, you've got to work. My schoolwork dropped quite a lot. It just went slowly downhill.
I think you can always go back to your education once you finish Grange Hill. I mean, I can go back and take some more O-levels if I wanted. I can go on and do A-levels. But, I mean, you get too old for Grange Hill. I mean, if I hadn't got it 3 years ago, I would never have really got a part, I don't think.
I think in acting you don't really need examinations, you know. So a director or whatever likes you, he's not going to turn you down because you haven't got an A-level, is he? That's the way I look at it. You know, take me for what I am, not how clever I am.
Academically wise, you're suffering, but I think you're learning other things. I mean, you're getting to know lots of people, you're working in a sort of professional atmosphere. It must help.
Now, this is a Grange Hill studio. It may look like a real school.
I wish you could come round to my house.
It's okay, I understand.
Look, when my dad arrives, I'll ask him if he'd mind giving you a lift home.
Oh, yeah, of course.
But it isn't.
I wish you could come round to my house.
It's okay, I understand. Look, when my dad arrives, I'll ask him if he'd mind giving you a lift home. Oh, yeah, of course.
Very nice, very nice. Could the scanner understand what was being said?
Yes, that was terrific, for sure.
Yes, yes, yes. Liked it. Yes.
Yes.
Okay, we'll break for lunch.
Okay, thank that you. Is lunch.
And this is one of our make-believe classrooms. Three walls and no ceiling. And that's our one and only corridor. There on the left.
Here we go then.
Jeff's further left, please.
Jeff's now happy. Wish I was. 1-5-3,
take one.
From the top, John.
I'm getting that out of there.
Action.
Well, he should be back by now, then.
Yeah, no, Clavery's probably skiving.
Yeah, well, he better be back by the end of the lesson.
What do you mean you think you might have lost some? I was gridiron, wasn't I? He fell out of my hands. But that means some won't get the reminder slip. Just don't blame me. Blame that McCullough kid.
Some of these look a bit sorry for themselves.
Well, I'm just going to wait till you get gridiron, then, eh? Just see how many lads you can take on.
Stop.
Now here's a bit of make-believe you will recognise. Mr. Bronson's wig.
I think that they are, in the main, completely unspoiled. It is interesting for me to work with them. It is a very great pleasure to come to work every day. They are not children, as far as I'm concerned. They are just a bunch of actors, or we are a bunch of actors, working together. And I thoroughly enjoy it. Right, you ready?
Okay, right.
Bronson taking shape. Now, you can tell everybody why I'm allowed to do this bit.
You're allowed to do this so that it feels comfortable and you know exactly the position. It just feels, it's like putting a hat on in a way. So, Mr. Bronson?
No, ready. It's not. No, it's not. Right. Glasses. Right. Blue pencil in place. And there is Mr. Bronson. Ready.
Oh, I do love it.
Here's Simon helping the director set up a quite difficult shot.
What if you could develop from something like that?
Just a tapping pencil.
Michael could afford to go a little bit to his right, please, Michael. Just a few inches, that's it.
Every shot has its own number, as you'll hear.
Cue Steve, cue Simon.
No, I know nothing about it, sir.
373, two next.
There's your name.
Yeah, well, I didn't write it.
Oh, it is a computer printout.
374.
Yeah, well, I don't know anything about it, so ask a member of staff.
375.
Well, I can't help you here, then.
377.
Perhaps I should try the computer room,
378.
Right, as soon as we've sorted out, the lights, we'll
fine. No problem.
Simon, to afford to lighten it a bit.
I am being a bit silly. Right.
One thing about being on Grange Hill, like it or not, you do get very famous.
We welcome your friends from Grange Hill!
That is me.
I never sort of see myself as famous. I just sort of, you just sort of go out in the street and you see kids and they say,
you're off Grange Hill, oh, can I have your autograph, whatever. And you just give it to them. I can't understand, I suppose, if I wasn't on Grange Hill, I would understand it a lot more, like seeing someone famous is such a big deal, or somebody off the telly. Now I can't, I just can't understand why they run over and want your autograph and want your pictures. It doesn't sink in at all. You just give it to them and smile.
I know they recognise me, but I don't say anything. I just sit there and try and keep quiet and try and look, like if I'm on the bus or something, or you say, thank you, thank you, like whispering. And then if it's girls, they start giggling and they just feel like, I'm hard.
It's nice when people are nice about it, when they sort of just come up to you and say, you know, and ask you about things and ask for your autograph. It's the ones that sort of follow you home and things like that. They follow you down the street and run after you. I haven't got that much, but sometimes I've got it, and it's pretty embarrassing because you don't know what to do.
I mean, there are obviously times when you have to be a bit quieter because you don't want to be too loud because you get noticed, and then you sometimes get hassled a bit.
What sort of hassle?
Well, just kids shouting things out in the street and sort of not always taking the mick, but just sometimes criticising you.
People can be unpleasant then, can they?
They can be.
What are they doing?
If I'm with a couple of my mates, they don't do anything like. But if, say I was on my own and there was about two of them or three of them, they'd like try and give it.
Try and give it?
Give it a big one, like start getting mouthy and all that.
It must be nice sometimes when girls come up and...
If they're nice, yeah. If they're nice girls. It's good if they're nice girls.
You get a load of screaming girls who love Robbie or they love Ziggy, and I mean, everywhere I've been, all they ask about is Robbie or Ziggy. That's all you ever hear. I mean, you don't get many boys asking about the girls. I've never come across a boy who said, oh, yeah, she's nice or whatever.
Well, why is that?
I don't know.
Well, boys like girls. Why shouldn't they ask that?
I don't. I think that girls are just a lot more into good-looking boys on telly. I don't think boys really care.
At the moment, you get more letters than anybody else in the cast.
Mm.
Why do you think that is?
I don't know. I never even knew I got more letters than anybody else. I never know. It's nice, isn't it? Yeah, I don't know.
But do you read the letters?
Yeah.
What do they say to you?
Just you got hunky body and all things like that. And I love you and all this. All soppy letters and all that. But it ain't soppy to them, because that's what my mum said. My mum said, yeah, I had a crush on Robert Redford when I was younger. And was...
So you got a sort of Robert Redford, are you?
No. Putting words into my mouth.
But there's someone on top of my wardrobe with a big box. Read them in a few years.
Your fan letters are all on top of your wardrobe?
Yeah, like in a big hi-fi box. Yeah. Just keep, got them, read a few, put them in there. You know, they're in my room, you know, I won't ever throw them away or not, you know.
Normally the people who send letters are sort of trying to be nice to you, so they sort of say, you know, they like the way you act, they think the way you portray your character is good, those sort of things. Don't get a lot of them.
You don't get these love letters that some of the boys get?
No, not a lot, no. Just the odd one or two. Can't explain it.
When you get older, you do things called PAs, or personal appearances, at discos and places like that. They're good fun, but you can get a bit nervous sometimes.
I never go on my own. I always go, like, I take my old man with me, you know, and my uncle, because he's a sort of, he's a minder, so he obviously goes. I go take a couple of my mates with me as well, big fellas, you know, who can handle themselves.
OK, so are you ready for Freddie?
Are you ready for
Freddie? Right, give him a warm round of applause. Freddie, how you doing?
OK, George, you ready?
Yeah.
Come on.
I'd never thought I'd have girls screaming at me, you know what I mean? I never ever thought that. Just go in, like, just like, sometimes it's like being in an animal in a cage, you know, all these girls screaming at you, like, looking at you.
George Christopher at Grange Hill. What did you think of that for an entrance?
It certainly must give them a lot of confidence to do that, because, you know, them girls can be quite frightening when there's about 500 screaming at you, asking you a lot of personal questions.
And Freddie, lots of people are asking, how old are you? How old are you now?
I'm 17.
17.
Have you got a girlfriend?
No, not at the moment, no.
Do you think he's good looking?
Yeah! I know if he wears boxer shorts or wife,
Fred. Yeah.
No, I'm wearing a pair of boxer shorts.
Boxer shorts?
What are you wearing, Ben?
What are you wearing, Ben?
Nothing.
Would you like to kiss Freddie on the cheek?
You're embarrassing me now.
I wouldn't say I'm shy, but I don't like doing things that I wouldn't normally do. I don't really like being seen, particularly.
But that's strange if you're an actor.
Well, no, but I mean, I'm in Grange Hill. I carry on being in Grange Hill because I like acting, but I don't like being in the public eye, as it were.
But I would have thought actors always like being in the public eye.
I don't know. maybe I'm the exception.
Of course you can. You will come to my rescue.
Do you think all this might make you conceited?
I don't think I'm conceited. I think that's probably a conceited comment in itself, but it's not real, is it? I mean, they're shouting at an image they've seen on television. They're not shouting at me. They don't know me. They've never met me before. I mean, that's how I got to look at it.
Can you get your
What sort of school is Grange Hill, do you think?
I think it's the case that Mrs. McCluskey runs a good school, that discipline is quite tight. And although there are one or two contretemps, it is a well-run, very caring school.
It's the sort of school that I would, in the days when I trained teachers, have been happy to have teachers working in, trainee teachers working in. Sort of school I'd have been happy to send my own children to.
I think it's a very happy place. I think they have a caring head and a head who knows most of the characters in the school. I would have been very happy to have worked in Grange Hill had it been a real school. The problems there seem fairly easy to solve and it seems quite a jolly place.
I think, you know, you sense that it's run by wit, intelligence, care and concern rather than very tight rules. I mean, it's a school representing some of the better characteristics of education in the 1980s and avoiding some of the worst characteristics of education, the thought that I had when I was at a grammar school in the 1940s.
Does it give you an impression of being a well-run school?
No. No.
Why?
I think there's far too much corridor wandering, for one, and I don't think we'd tolerate that. Pupils in a classroom before a lesson starts is a bad idea.
You all right after the other day?
Yeah, not bad, you?
Yeah, thanks.
I don't see an awful lot of evidence of work being done. You know, it's always the art project, or at least this is the impression I got, or the radio project. You never actually see, now you have 45 minutes to do this essay on Of Mice and Men, under exam conditions, please do so. Again, 45 minutes of watching kids write wouldn't make the headlines, but I think that comes across to kids as well.
Right, gather round, please. Gather round. That's it. Right, after the splendour of the science rock and the gym, we now find ourselves in the main playground of the school. Now, the buildings to your left were built sometime in the past and have not yet fallen down, which accounts for the fact they're still here.
It isn't really that similar to normal schools because, I mean, I can't think of anyone who's like Grange, personally. But then again, I mean, there have got to be characters who are sort of a bit extrovert, a bit outrageous, because you're obviously trying to entertain people. You're trying to make a programme that people want to watch, and having sort of characters who do strange things is entertaining, I suppose.
Some people tell me that if you watch Grange Hill, it encourages you to behave badly and sets a bad example.
It's like saying, oh, you can't watch this because it's going to make you do this. You can't watch EastEnders because it's going to make you be naughty. You can't watch Grange Hill because it's going to make you be naughty in class. You can't watch this. And it's just stupid because if you're good, then you're hardly going to change bad just because somebody on television is. A lot of people, they don't... I think that the people who say that are mainly adults. Yeah. Don't think any children say that they behave how people on the television do.
I think the people that are good, they won't change by watching Grange Hill because they know that Grange Hill is all acting and it's not real and that'll never happen.
I've heard from friends who said that some of the things that I did in Grange Hill were sometimes copied at their schools. But, I mean, the things I did really weren't horrible or evil. They were just a bit naughty.
Loads of people say that.
Say what?
That Grange Hill's a bad influence. I know some people that aren't allowed, their children aren't allowed to watch it.
If children want to watch Grange Hill, it's up to them, really.
Well, it's up to their parents, perhaps.
Well, if their parents think they shouldn't watch it, well, they've got to obey their parents, but I don't think it's a bad influence.
I think if you went to a normal school, just a comprehensive school, and filmed for the whole day what was going on, you'd be surprised. Mm. Compared to Grange Hill, Grange Hill's mild.
But you do tend to want to idealise school as an adult. And what this programme does is say, no, you can't idealise school. You know, it is composed of real people with warts, real moments of anger, emotion, real moments when the harmony breaks down, when the kind of notion of a pure academy of pure learning just doesn't wash, but it never did.
Do you think children, having seen Grange Hill on a Tuesday or a Friday, will come to school the next day having learned bad habits?
No. I think kids have much more intelligence than that. They can separate television from real life. And certainly if they can't, then certainly in this school they would be reminded that Grange Hill is a TV programme and Acland Burley is a real school. Time to get down to work.
Ireland! Ireland on that one! Ireland! Super young angels! Angels! Super young! Ireland down there!
Down there!
Oh, I'll
see you next Tuesday, all right?
See you, Joe.
John?
If I'm joking.
No, you're not.
Go on, hang on, Ron.
Have you got an ambition yet?
I'd like to go into acting, I think. But other than that, I haven't really thought about it.
Have you got an ambition?
Well, I did have an ambition that was to be on this, but now I've just changed. I'd like to be an astronaut.